Hello and welcome along to this second part of the Mindburner video on the RGD1046 Classic British Amp. In part one I had some success and also a bit of a failure with a couple of caps and things like that, but generally things went well and I was able to get the amp to a position where I'm ready to power it on. Let's have a look at that.
So what's this bit of crazy technology? Well, all it is an incandescent light bulb wired in line with a mains plug. And the idea behind that is that the mains lead goes up and into here. Now, I don't have a ball gun plug, so I've basically taken the leads off the back of the plug and just crimped them, or you know, connected them in with these little quick connects into the power line. So basically what will happen is that when this is plugged in, this bulb, any massive current draw will make the bulb really grow brightly, which will indicate a current problem. And I should switch it off pretty quick. It's like a short or something like that. It's basically like a big fuse, but I should use a variac for this and bring the power up gradually, but I don't have one of those, so I'm just going to do the old light bulb trick. So I've also noticed that these wires here need to be jumpered, and they are on my other amp, so it's kind of like an external power port, probably for the radio. So they're jumpered on the other one, so I've just temporarily jumpered them here. So I'm kind of ready almost to power this thing up. You know, I've done the cap reforming as best I can. I've replaced the DC coupling capacitors here with stuffed ones. I've checked the wiring on the amp. I've sort of had a look at the circuit diagram and did the jumper there. I've got my inline bulb, so I think I'll just give it a go and see what happens. There's going to be a point when you have to do this, and I think this is it now. So I've gone ahead and fitted the rectifier. It's the UU8, which is from LRDG, it's the one I had handy. So it's also easy to see if it lights up, because you can actually see little dots on the top. So I'm going to just plug this in and see what happens. I mean, this is really the first time. What I should expect to see is the bulb go a little bit brighter and then dim down and not draw too much current, so it should be sort of dimish. Alright, okay. Really low. Here we go. Still a bit of ramping as well. So if I look over that, you can probably see like the little glowing dots there. So the rectifier is actually rectifying. So that's kind of a good sign. And there isn't a massive increase in brightness of the bulb. So I'm gonna put the other two valves in here. The SP41 and the HL41. So here we have the other two valves fitted. I'm just going to do the same thing. Hope for the best. Oh, so you get a brighter increase and then it drops down. And as the cap charges up, it should get a bit brighter. So that's also quite good because there's no massive increase in brightness. And if you can see there, just on the SP41, there's a little bit of brightness just in the valve, so it's getting power as well. So this is good news so far. Of course, the big one is going to be putting the PX4s in. So here we have the two PX4s from my other RGD amplifier. So they're about to go into the amp. I'm a bit nervous about this, just in case, you know, it does something to these, because they're about £300 a piece. But there's going to be a point comes I just have to try it, because I've done everything else that I can with the amp. So here we have the PX4s installed. I haven't switched it on yet, and that's what I'm going to do now. So this is really the big kind of kahuna. So there we go. Brightens up, dims down a bit. Should probably brighten a bit more as current's drawn. Yeah, a little bit. Oh, it's getting bright. It's not getting radically bright, so this may be okay. Yeah. Hasn't gone bang. So I've connected up a monitor audio MA4 speaker into the amp, and then used my lead from RGD into the little Bluetooth player, which is going to be part kind of transmitted from my phone. So yeah, here we go. Plug it in again. There goes the bulb. Goes the amp. So I'm just going to get the phone and stick on a track, make sure it's Bluetoothable. So Oh, so okay, it is playing, which is quite amazing, but it's quite distorted. Right, okay. So that's good that we're getting something. Distortion there, but I'm wondering if it's just because this is taking too much power. I mean, the bulb's in line here. So I'm going to remove the bulb and try it again. So bypass the bulb there, and I'm just going to power it up. There we go. So that was good. It actually sounds a lot better. No distortion on the actual sound, but there is this background hum. I'm wondering, is it to do with the smoothing capacitor? Because that sounds very like the kind of stuff that I have with synths when smoothing capacitors are shot or not working very well. So, I did reform them, but maybe they're not good enough. Plus, I also didn't check that one that was really leaked. It did seem to start to reform, but it may be, you know, no good. So I'll have to investigate that, but I'm pretty pleased that I'm actually getting audio out of this thing, and it is working, it seems, which is quite a result. So while investigating the hum that you heard, I decided to bypass this leaky cap and put in a modern 400 volt 15UF cap, and it has reduced the hum quite a bit, so that's good. So it does make me suspect that the other caps are responsible for some of the background hum also. And really, you know, they're ancient, although they're, you know, reformed and whatever quite well. You know, how good are they? No, probably not that good. So if I can be bothered, I'm going to take the cap out and then hollow it out and put the modern cap inside it.
So you can see this area of discoloration and rust and contamination. And this is probably from the capacitor that leaked. It's in the same corner beneath the capacitor. So electrolyte has dropped onto the base plate here and caused this.
So here we have an electrolytic capacitor which has been opened up. So what I did is I just sawed it in half. Now this is a lovely capacitor, but it's really dry and it's reading about 2 microfarads. So it's a 16, so I really need to get it sorted. So I'm just going to put the other cap inside and take the energy out of this. Okay, so I've hollowed out quite a bit of this capacitor. So what I'm going to do is just put this one in. I'm going to just create a false base here, and then I've drilled some holes at the top so the leads can poke out, and then wrap them around. Now this is a bit of an ugly cut. It's not bad, but it's going to be hidden behind the cot that holds, or the bracket that holds the capacitor into the case. And from the bottom, then you're not going to know it's been stuffed either, so it should look pretty good. So just as well, I've got a couple of helpers here who are out in my shed.
Hello.
So that's Jude and that's Evie, and they're helping me with my renovation tonight.
So that's the stuffed capacitor reinstalled, and I think it looks quite good. You know, you can't really see the cut or anything there, and the, as I say, the bracket has covered it over.
Just the underside of it.
So I just thought I'd do some testing on the amp while it's running, and I've just measured across R47 a bias resistor, I think for the PX4s. So it's running at 46 volts, which I think's about right for this amp. And I think the anode voltage on the PX4s is about 344. So according to posts I've put up on radio forums before and stuff about the PX4s, that seems pretty ballpark. So that's kind of encouraging. Still getting this very low frequency hum, which I don't know why. And I've changed out a lot of capacitors and basically everything. So I'm a bit worried it's like one of the chokes here or something, because it's making a slight vibrating noise. So I don't know whether that's anything to do with it. It's just the age. You know, it's low, and I have earthed the chassis as well. And it seems okay, so still investigating. I just thought it's worth showing you how to safely discharge a capacitor. This is a little 4400 UF 63 volt capacitor, and I'm sticking in 32 volts, which is the half my bench power supply can go to. So this will alarmingly hold the 32 volts after power is taken off, which is what it's designed to do, of course. So I'll just show you how to discharge it. So this is some time later, and I'm just going to show you that the charge is still on the capacitor. 31.64 volts. So if you put your hand in that, you're going to get a bit of a shock. Now it's not a huge shock, it's 30 volts, but if that was a 250 volt cap, you know, it's going to ruin your day. I'm going to discharge it now. So what I've done is I've just built this little homemade cap discharger. Now basically what it is just a large resistor, a 5-watt job, 22K, which is what I had hanging around. So you just basically put it on here, and watch what happens to the voltage now. So start to see that drop. Now, a lot of people just stick a big screwdriver across it, which you can do, and it makes a nice bright sparks, but on a larger capacitor it can be a bit daunting to do that. And also, I'm just super careful after having a shock a few years ago that really kind of affected me. So, you know, this is the way I would do it. Okay, so we're now at 6 odd volts, and that's nice, pretty much safe to handle, although a lot of people let it go to zero. And here we have the fun way to do it with insulated screwdriver. So I ended up just using the original capacitors because the replacements didn't seem to really make a huge difference. So I thought I'd just roll with the originals and keep an eye on them. You know, they may reform more in the actual set. So, you know, I do have the first one there, as I say, stuffed, the bottom one, and the other ones are original. So it seems to be working okay with those. It did make a lot of difference to the actual sound. What they did do is increase the voltage over the R47 and into the valve. So something like, you know, I think it was 48 volt, and it's like 46 with the old caps, 48 with the new ones. So here we have the amp, and I'm pretty pleased with the way it's turned out. You know, it seems to be operating within parameters. The valves do get very hot, but my other one, the valves got very hot as well. And as far as I can see, the specs are okay on this, you know, with around about 46 volts gone to each valve. And you know, it's maybe just the way it is. Sometimes these older valves pull a lot, you know, they're quite strong valves, and maybe the amp is, you know, shouldn't be matched with these particular PX4s. I'm just not too sure about that, but yeah, it does work. There's still a slight sound on the, like, buzzing sound on the output. It's kind of like a low sound, so I'm just not sure what that is. And I have been getting a bit of a clicking, but that might be something interfering in this room here. There's a lot of other gear in here on the audio, so I need to really bring it into where I'm going to put the amp with the other one. But I may run a sort of step down transformer on the input so that it's not full 240 going into it. It's like maybe 225. I do that with the other one, and it just reduces the power of the amp a little bit, but it should make the valves last longer. So that's the sound I'm getting, that sort of pop, pop, pop on the buzzing, which doesn't go up and down with the volume, so it's present all the time. So here we have my original RGD on the right, and the new one on the left. So personally, I think they're things of beauty, you know, they just look really great together, and I'm just comparing them. Now, the only problem is I only have one power lead, and I'm waiting for the bulging plug to come from a supplier. So I can only really take the one. But it's quite interesting to look at the different readings. For instance, the other one across the valve was 47. Now this one is, you can see that, 38. Now the reasons for that will be the fact that it's running from this power conditioner, which I'm going to show you in a minute. And also the fact that it's got a U7 in it. But that is actually reasonably low. I think it should be maybe around about 40, 41, but it sounds grand. I'm still getting the little hum in the background and this little ticking noise. Very low. I've reversed it here, but it hasn't really made a big difference. So there could be something funny happening in one of the components. I just don't know. But it's not a major issue. I'll continue to have a look at it. Now, I don't know if you can see the one on the right, if I can just pan in. It's got a different resistor than the one on the left. And that's the bass resistor, and it was reduced really to kind of spur the valves a little bit, because they were running about 51 volts per valve. So that brings it down on that amp. You can see also a couple of 47R resistors in the, I think it's the input to the rectifier. So the amp on the left doesn't have these mods, and it's running reasonably low, 38 volts. The valves are getting warm, but they're not as hot as they were, super hot, you know. I don't know enough about these amps really to sort of compare and contrast too much, but output wise they seem to be roughly the same. And I think there is an option to put a volume control on these, so that might be a way of balancing them out a little bit. But yeah, it's good I've got it working, and I've now ordered another valve for this. So I already have quite a nice nozzle valve, which I've had for a while. So this marvellous box here, which is turned off at the minute obviously, is my sort of step down on the mains to drop it down by about 7%. Just again, as a bit of a valve saver. Now it contains amazing audio equipment in here to make the sound just super smooth and vibrant, and it's basically just a neon and a big transformer. So what I'm going to do is just put in maybe some IEC females here or something. I might be able to run both off the one, I'm not too sure. So with the amp essentially working, I thought I'd give it a little bit of a clean up. I'm not going to do very much to it. I was going to paint it, but I might just leave it like this for a while. I quite like this aged look. Bit of rust around here, and it's a bit rough. So what I'm going to do with the amp part off, of course, is just clean up here with a little bit of fine sandpaper. Be careful not to take off the valve markings. And just give it a clean up so that it's like a smoother version of what it is. It's just a little bit of wet and dry. Back. It did start with a bit of like, I don't know what you call it, frying, that kind of crackling, and then this sound. So it's a bit unnerving, but I did notice that the amp dropped in power and the top end sort of went a bit. So I decided to bypass the large capacitor, the 30UF, I put a 47UF in, and the power's back up, but the hum's still there. So I'm going to really recap all these, or restuff all these caps, because this reforming malarkey, I mean, yeah, it's gonna work sometimes, and it's, you know, but eventually these caps are gonna fail, so might as well replace them now. So yeah, it was kind of interesting that the amp really died off there. And I just noticed with this cap, hopefully you can see there, there's leakage, and this was side hidden under the circuit board. So this thing has been kind of dripping out there, the electrolytic. So, you know, reforming these things, it's a bit of a mug's game sometimes. And such an old piece of kit, worth a try, and I think I did quite well with it, but I think I'm going to just cut this along the edge here and put a decent cap in it. Now it's a 30UF, so I put a 47UF in, which will, if anything, be better, but certainly will make no real difference. So there you go. RGD amp repair has been finished and done to a reasonable quality. I've now got both amps working and I'm just waiting my second valve arriving. So that's coming from Billington, which is a great company in the UK who supply valves. They're sort of wholesale, but they do support DIYers and people refurbing quality kit. So definitely worth checking out there. But basically, I think that's it for me. I think the amps work really, really well, and they sound great, and I just haven't paired up with a pair of MA4s here, which are not ideal because of 8 ohm speakers, but it does sound great actually in the room here, and it's just really for listening in this garden room. Yeah, I'm really pleased with them. I haven't actually painted the one that's a bit dodgy there yet, but I may do that. That's just a matter of like taking them off and spraying them, you know, the transformer covers, or masking and spraying. So I hope you've enjoyed it, okay, and if you like what you see, like and subscribe, and I'll see you back for another video.